Hi, everybody. Hope your night's going well. It's a little bit interesting with everything going on for sure around here. Total change to our world, but thought we would, get everybody on and talk some bass fishing. You know, there's so much going on in the world right now and just crazy times. So I, think that we're lucky to be part of an industry that all sticks together. And, I think we'll get through this, but just want to have some fun, keep it lighthearted, be positive, and just have a good time. So that's what we're going to do tonight. Talk some bass fishing, do some different things. We'll wait for a few people to have just started here at 8, and we'll go through it together. We're going to answer some questions. I've got my two boys helping out tonight with that. Jackson and Nicholas sitting across from me over here. We've, like you say, this last week has been different. They're both in college, so they're home. Now some of their classes are online. Some of their class, Jackson's in culinary school, so his labs, they can't do. So we're having a little more family time. We're doing a lot of different things. We've been playing games. We've been, hanging out. We've been, we're fortunate that we live out in the country. I've got a pond in my backyard. We've got a farm right down the street. We, can go shed hunting. We can walk the property. We can do some different things and adhere to social distancing. We can fish. And, that's one thing that, as a professional angler, it's pretty hard to not go fishing. So, I've got plenty of time now to focus on my tackle. It doesn't look like it'd be very smart to have any tournaments anytime soon at all. I don't think anybody really knows what's going to happen or how long this is going to go. So we're all in it together, and we'll just, if everybody does their part and, it listens to what the CDC says, I think we can get through this and be a lot better on the other side. I've already learned a lot about it. It's interesting to look on social media and to see all the people whose lives have changed with homeschooling their kids and trying to work from home, do different things. And that's the hard thing, for an angler is, it's a total different world, but social media is so important, and it's such a powerful tool. I think we can definitely have some fun. So, one of the big things to me is I'm an outdoors person. I grew up hunting and fishing. It's what I love to do. We got a lot of things happening this time of year that you can get outside and do. And it's one of the smart things that we can all do to be safe is, as long as we follow the right guidelines, is to get out. You can hike, you can run, you can go fishing, you can go shed hunting, you can go, mushroom season's coming up real soon around here. A lot of things you can do to get outside. And it was interesting, a little over a week ago, I was on my way home from the Bass Pro Tour event in Texas, and all this was just hitting the fan. And, it was just really changing quickly. And I talked to Johnny Morris on the trip, and we were actually trying to plan a fishing trip. And, without the schedule knowing what's going to happen, it's really hard to do that. So, but we talked and I brought up to him that, certain states were starting to shut down access to their parks and things like that. And to me, that's not a good thing. You can only stay cooped up in your house for so long. And I know it's important, and safety is everybody's priority, doing the right things and trying to get through this as quick as possible. But you have to keep your sanity too. And there's, as long as you're doing things where you're not exposing yourself to anybody else or others to you, it's totally safe to be outside. And I think it's healthy. So, fishing is one of those things. And a lot of states have came out and said, hey, we want you to go fishing. I know the Michigan DNR posted that they, they've waived access fees and ramp fees, and their parks are open and things like that. So I applaud them for doing that. So the big thing is, is really look in your area and see what opportunities that you have. And, you know, it's great to get out, you know, and go fishing. You can go take your family, just like, you know, the boys and I, we're going to be going fishing through this lockdown. You know, our governor just yesterday put us on that lockdown, and it's kind of gray. So I actually got the resolution and read it. You know, a friend of mine, Louis Stout, he runs Michigan Outdoor News. It's a great local publication in Southern Michigan and Northern Indiana. You know, he's usually writing about, you know, what the hot tips are and, you know, what's going on in the bass fishing world or, you know, different outdoors activities. But he actually, emailed the state senator to get clarification. And when I saw the resolution and read it, I saw that, you know, they absolutely, and that's what they said is, we absolutely want people to go fishing. It's good to be outside and it's healthy to do. So, you know, it's important to do, you know, places like my brother's store at DNR Sports, you know, this is the time of the year that, that is their busiest time, you know, that's boat sale season. Their big spring show is on Easter weekend every year. And obviously they're not going to be able to have that. You know, they chose to close, today was their first day closed, but they're still keeping their online store open because, you know, if you need a, you know, a pack of Ochos or something like that, your fishermen are still going to want to get it. So it's important for, you know, businesses to be able to function if they can, you know, through this time for sure, to be able to get through it. And I know there's a lot of anglers that are going to appreciate that. I looked at the Bass Pro website and saw that, you know, the vast majority of all the Bass Pro and Cabela's stores are still open in certain areas where they can be. And then obviously they're still available online, and a lot of people are looking for outdoor equipment right now to be able, because it's that time of year. So that's, I think, you know, that's one of the things we want to do is get out and, you know, experience the outdoors. This is one of my favorite times to fish here in Michigan, you know, early spring. It's only been a handful of years in my lifetime that you can actually fish, catch and release in the early season in Michigan. So, you know, the last few years, I've learned just how good the fishing is. You know, you can just have some incredible days out on the water now. I mean, the water's still really cold. It's in the 40s, but the fish move shallow almost immediately after ice out. And we've had a couple little warm-ups and we've had a few cold fronts. We had snow just a day ago. So you get these weather fronts this time of year, but the fish haven't been pressured. You know, I mean, we haven't had a lot of ice this year, so ice fishing was not a real prolonged season. A lot of guys got out and did a little bit of bluegill fishing, but I love to bass fish through the ice. And with our schedule, you know, starting in February with the Bass Pro Tour down at Lake Eufaula, I actually never got out. We didn't have good ice or safe ice to be able to make it happen. So I went to my pond the other day and caught a really nice smallmouth on a jerkbait. And I mean, it was super cold. We've got even a little skim ice in a lot of places on the shores at night. And, you know, but these fish are a lot more active, especially in our colder waters than you would think. So it's a great time to get out and fish. And, you know, my favorite, you know, spring pattern is definitely lipless crankbaits and like a red eye shad. Straight King red eye shad is one of my favorites. As soon as the bass move up on the flats, they start eating red eye shads, especially if you get a windy day or cloudy day, you know, get a south wind blowing, go to the north shore if there's a flat there, and you can catch them with a red eye shad. If it's a little bit deeper breaks, most of our lakes are clear, you know, suspending jerk bait. You know, I use a standard KVD 300 series in most lakes. Some of the lakes around me that are deeper, you know, Gull Lake's one of my favorites. You know, the deep dive inversion is critical there. Most of the breaks there, the weed lines, you know, are 20 feet deep. So you want a deeper running bait for a situation like that. So, you know, that's the things that I'm thinking about heading out doing, right now. And, you know, we've already had, you know, three tournaments this year, you know, down south, one in Florida, one in Alabama, and one in Texas. And, you know, you just see, you know, so many trends. But the biggest thing already this year, and we say it every single year, is Mother Nature and the weather. just how crazy it is. And, you know, we've seen it at all those times and all three events, and it's been, you know, it's been challenging. I've had, you know, my ups and downs this year already, but it's been a lot of fun. So, you know, I want to take a lot of time, answer a lot of questions tonight too. So, you know, send in your questions. The boys will be reading them off to me, and, you know, we'll talk about bass fishing. But the main thing is I just like to talk to people that like to talk bass fishing. You know, it's a time for all of us to be positive. We've got, again, like I said, early in this, in the broadcast, that we've got a great industry of people that all will help anybody at any second's notice. And that's what we really need to do. These are going to be challenging times for everybody. You know, my parents are in Florida. They spend the winter down there. They're both at risk, you know, for this virus, at high risk. You know, my mom has a triple bypass last fall, and my dad's had a, you know, heart procedures in the past. He's diabetic, you know, and they're in their 80s. So it's paramount that you take care of people that you can, like that. So, you know, we're doing everything we can to help them out. We're going to get them back up here soon in the spring, and that's what we want to do. So let's get to some questions, though. I think this will be good. Again, I got Nicholas and Jackson here looking at it. They're helping out tonight. So what do we got?
Okay. First question, lithium pro trolling motor question. What is the reason for running 3 12-volt lithium batteries versus 2 36-volt lithium pros like some other guys?
Well, I like to have extra running time. So basically, with the lithium pros batteries, and if you haven't done any research on lithium batteries or anything like that, Lithium Pros has a great website. They have a lot of information, but what a lithium battery does for you more than anything is they're really lightweight and they give you a lot more running time. So you can get them in, you know, 12, 24 or 36 volt systems. So you could potentially, with a Minn Kota Ultrex like I run, that's 36 volt, you could run just one battery if you wanted to. It's just your running time would be limited. So what I wanted to do was get 3 12 volts, put them together, you know, all together, so that I make one big battery, one big bank. And then if I ever needed to jump a crank battery or anything like that, I could use one of those batteries to do that. So I actually am running 4 Lithium Pro batteries. One is a crank battery, and then 3 of the biggest trolling motor batteries that they have. And I literally can go several days if I needed to, on one full charge with it. So it just really gives me an unbelievable amount of runtime, and they only weigh 27 pounds a piece, whereas the big AGMs that I was running were 89 or, you know, close to 90 pounds a piece. So there's a huge weight savings. It's a huge performance advantage. I get a lot more runtime out of them, and they last and last. I mean, these batteries will last for, you know, 10 plus years the way that I use them. For you know, somebody else, they may last a lot longer. So they're more expensive up front. The price has come down on them quite a bit in the last year. But I mean, long term, they're an unbelievable value. And they just, a regular batteries just don't compare to them power wise. You know, my Minn Kota 112 Ultrex basically has about 150 pounds of thrust with these batteries because they're so much hotter. I mean, my gauge when I charge them full, has them up, you know, I mean, they'll read like 43.5 volts, you know, so it's not a 36 volt system. They run hotter, and, you know, the trolling motor's fine with it. I've been running them for years. So it really does increase your power, your runtime, your overall bolt performance. They're just, once you run them, there's just no, you know, going back. The big deal is the cost to have 4 of them as opposed to 3 or 2. But they are definitely something that is worth investing into, especially when you fish professionally like I do. So, you got some more questions?
Oh, yeah. Hold on just a second. Hey, Kevin. Actually, this one's better. My water just went out. Where and what to look for? What first bait to throw at them?
So, really, the thing that I look for at ice out is the water clarity and the type of habitat. You know, where I live in Michigan, most of our lakes would be considered pretty clear by most standards. Even the ones that have some color to them are still pretty darn clear. And the bass start to move fairly shallow really quickly right after ice out. I mean, the water temperature stays cold as long as there's ice on the lake. And then as soon as that ice melts, you get a pretty quick jump in surface temperature. And like here, a lot of our lakes have some shallow flats and that. You get a south wind, it'll really warm the water up on these northerly banks and these northerly flats quick. And those fish go shallow, sometimes overnight. So, I mean, I've caught them in water that was frozen a couple of days before, up in 2 foot of water in just a few, in just a few days. So it really depends on the terrain of the lake on what I'm going to use. But my favorite baits right after ice out is definitely, a Strike King red eye shad, a suspending jerk bait, like a KVD 300 or a 300 deep, depending on, the depth of the lake. And then you got to have some finesse baits too. A Ned rig is going to be a really good one. I've always used like darter heads, tubes, things like that as a grub type or as a bottom bouncing lure right at ice out. Something a little smaller profile than say a jig is. And then not long after, you can get into, bladed jigs like a Thunder Cricket and even swim jigs. I've had some great early season days with a swim jig, fishing dead pad stems and dead reeds, dead vegetation. Bass are going to gravitate to those dark bottom areas as soon as the sun starts shining. And believe it or not, even though the water's cold, the radiant heat from sun really makes a big difference in warming that bottom, and it'll pull those fish shallow. They're going to get to dark spots. So you want to look for dark bottom areas early in the season. A lot of our lakes in Michigan are real sandy, especially the smallmouth lakes. And the darkest bottom, the darkest patches of grass, old dead oak leaves that have blown in the lake from last year that are washed into a shallow trough, those fish will go up there and sit on top of those. And it's just like they're sunbathing, but you can catch them. So it's a great time to find a big concentration of fish. So got some more.
Yeah.
Jackson, what do you got?
Here's one. Mercury propeller question.
Yep.
Do you ever change the propeller on that new Mercury in different tournament settings? Example, shallow water events or low long run events or hot summer water?
So the one thing that I'll tell you about the new Mercury 4-stroke Pro XS is it's the most amazing, unbelievable engine that I've ever run. And, I feel really fortunate that I'm sponsored by them to have such an incredible piece of equipment. What I've put mine through in the last 2 years, what I put mine through already this season down at Lake Okeechobee is it's incredible to ask an outboard to run in that shallow water. And that I've ran aground and got into a really muddy area and overheated it and things like that to where it shouldn't be even feasible. But what I've done is I found a setup for my Nitro Z21 that really works well. So I run a 23 pitch, 3-blade Fury. The real advantage to me performance-wise that helps me a lot is the Atlas jack plate on the back. So I've got a hydraulic Atlas, and being able to run that up and down to idle through shallow areas or to take off in real shallow areas like we were at, when we were at Lake Okeechobee, water level was down. If you couldn't take off in 2 foot of water, you might have to idle for a mile to find 2.5 foot. So it was really, really important to have that Atlas jack plate to power it down. I mean, the low end torque and the mid range, everything about the new Mercury Pro XS is incredible. If you haven't seen one, if you haven't experienced one and you're thinking about repowering or you're thinking about a new boat, go and do a test drive because it'll blow you away, especially compared to, what we used to have. The Mercury 2-stroke Pro XS was a great engine. It was lightweight. It was the fastest, most fuel efficient, high performance engine out there at the time. And this new 4-stroke outperforms it in every aspect, including fuel economy. I have tried a 24 and it just really doesn't change much for it. So that 23 or 24, this engine is is really overcomes a lot of the things we have to use to do with changing prop pitches and using four blades and things like that, just because it has so much torque. So
here's one. Will there be any Lou's KVD series rod and reels coming soon?
There is. I'm actually fishing with a whole bunch of them right now. We are planning on introducing them at ICAST. You know, this whole thing with the coronavirus has slowed down a lot of companies in a lot of ways. But I think we're still on target for launching at ICAST. So I have, fiberglass composite crankbait rods, in the series. I've got regular graphite bait cast rods, everything from rods targeted for jerkbaits and spinnerbaits to worms and flipping and topwaters, and then a whole series of graphite spinning rods too. And I've got a lot of them that I really have geared towards, specialty finesse techniques, for drop shots, for smallmouth fishing, some longer rods that have really extra fast tapers to them. I think when you see these rods, you're going to be really, really impressed. And one of the big things that we wanted to focus on both the rods and the reels, is create something that was affordable. I mean, a really quality piece that's going to be an incredible value in the marketplace. That's something that we talked about from the beginning, and I really challenged the team to do. And I'm just really, really thrilled. I've been fishing them since the beginning of the year already, the set that I have. Got some more coming now, and it's really coming together. So I'm super excited about them. I think, when you see them, you're going to be surprised. And we're really changing the game value-wise for the quality that we're going to be putting out in these new Lou's rods and reels.
Here's one, Dan. Are you and Zona going to do another show?
I would hope so. I do shows for the Bass Pros. I do shows for Strike King, and we do that. He does his own show. The biggest challenge that we've had is, that he's got his own show. He's also the host of the Bassmasters, and I fish Major League Fishing, the Cup events and the Bass Pro Tour, and our schedules are so different that it makes it a little more challenge. But we still fish a lot, or fish some together. And now with this, I got to imagine that we're going to do some social distancing and find each other on the same lake someplace real soon. What do you got, Nick?
Sorry, I'm
having Lola's wanting to be part of the action too. So we got a new family member.
Mercury propeller question.
No, you ever,
I did that one.
What reel, rod, and line do you use to cast the small 1.5 crankbaits?
That's a good question. The KVD 1.5 is arguably one of my favorite crankbaits. It's a really versatile bait that I can use in a lot of different situations, a lot of different cover situations, and fish it with a lot of different sizes of line. And my favorite rod for it is a 7-foot composite medium action, cranking rod. So it's got a mix of glass and graphite both. So it gives you the sensitivity of a graphite rod, but that slower reaction time, the way it loads and unloads when it's deflecting off rocks and stumps and cover and things like that, and allows the fish to get the bait a little bit deeper. And the other big thing about it is the way they cast. A composite rod just really it takes a lot less effort to throw, real far. And like I said, because it's got a blend of graphite and glass, you're not giving up any sensitivity. It's got plenty of power to get the crankbait ripped out of grass or anything like that. But I just land so many more fish. When you use that rod with, a reel matched with fluorocarbon, it just really gives you a really powerful weapon to get a lot of strikes, to generate a lot of strikes, and to land most of those bites that you're going to get.
Really windy days on ultra clear water, what is your go-to lure for smallmouth?
So when it's really windy on real clear water for smallmouth, it's a challenge. That's the type of days that it's very hard to fish any type of finesse bait. You can put a heavier weight on your drop shot, or you can snap a heavy tube around and things like that. And there's sometimes you know, late in the year, or early in the year, that, you know, slower moving baits like that are the only way to go. But my favorite is a spinner bait. You know, when it gets really windy, you know, the light penetration is really cut down. What you want to do with that spinner bait is keep it high in the water column so they don't get too good a look at it, and make it erratic. You know, I'm going to jerk it, stop it and start it, fish it pretty darn fast, to get it, you know, to get those reaction strikes. You can do the same thing. You know, you can catch some fish definitely with a jerk bait, but there's nothing more efficient than covering water than a spinner bait. My second choice would be a Strike King red eye shad. That's another bait when it's really windy, that's really easy to cast. You're real efficient to cover those flats and things like that. It's just better if the water's a little shallower. The thing about that spinner bait is I can fish it in a lot of different depth zones, and I can draw the bass a long ways to get it when it's real clear. So it's been one of my favorites for really my whole life. I love the way they hit a spinner bait.
Here's one. Thanks, KVD. I fish Southern Michigan water. What's the go-to lure this time of year?
Well, it's about to be the prime time for the Strike King red eye shad. I mean, that is, most of our lakes here in Southern Michigan have a lot of shallow flats. We got a lot of vegetation, and, you know, ripping a red eye shad, just, you know, working it through the grass, just fish it just fast enough to get it caught in the grass, pull it free and let it flutter down. The thing about a red eye shad is when it sinks, it has like a shimmy to it. So it just kind of flutters down, and that's what you want to do. You want to rip it out of the grass and let that bait fall. And you almost fish it like a jig, you know, pull it sideways and let it fall. And it's a great bait. I also use a lot of jerk baits. And if it's real weedy, you know, a bladed jig like a Thunder Cricket is going to be really hard to beat. That usually starts up just a little bit later. You know, the first baits that they bite after ice out, the first hard baits for sure are jerk baits and lipless crankbaits like a red eye.
Here's one, Dan. What is a good spinnerbait for muddy water?
Well, in muddy water, you want a spinnerbait that has a lot of vibration. So I'm going to use something that has a lot of thump, and that means Colorado blades or an Indiana blade. So, you know, usually I like a smaller spinnerbait, a 3/8 ounce that's going to make the fish, you know, it's going to stay in the strike zone longer. The fish are typically shallow when the water's real muddy like that anyway. So, you know, a double Colorado, 3/8 ounce, you know, Strike King with a, you know, it's got a 4.5 or a rear blade on it. You're going to use a bright color like chartreuse, things like that. That's really what I'm going to use. So muddy water, it's all about vibration. Lola, are you going crazy or what? The whole table's shaking. She's down there biting at our feet.
Okay, here's another one, Dad. What reel, rod, and line do you use to cast this? Or no, I already said that. What is your most memorable tournament?
You know, I've had a ton of great memories in tournaments. I've had a lot of great moments over the years. I think probably the biggest one for me was winning the Classic in New Orleans the last time, because on the final day I had a really good day. And I absolutely knew that with the lead that I had, that I had it probably won. And, you know, with your family, you know, back there, not knowing exactly what you catch, you know, they don't, it wasn't like it was live or they knew exactly what, you know, what we had. It's not like now where, you know, every fish we catch, we score and you know what the weight is. So there's a lot of uncertainty. So when I came in knowing in my mind, that I had it won, especially because I knew, you know, the other competitors that were waiting there too, to be able to watch their reaction and see, because, you know, your family sacrifices so much when you're out on tour, and to be able to win a big event like that is something pretty special, you know, for your whole family, and everybody's under a lot of stress and a lot of things like that. So that's probably my favorite all-time memory.
Favorite red eye shad color?
So in the springtime like this, it's all about crawfish or bluegill patterns. You know, you want to use things that are natural, you know, in these clear water lakes and things like that, you know, bluegill patterns, crawfish patterns. One that we make that is really one that I love around here is one we call baby carp. It's kind of a burnt orange, coppery, color. That's a really good one. The natural bluegill or the orange brim. Those are two really, really good ones. And then any of the crawdads too. You know, the dark brown crawdad is a great one, especially if you're fishing in dark bottom areas. So if you can pick a color that matches the background that you're fishing. So, you know, if you're fishing a milfoil bed with a lot of green weeds, you know, something that's watermelon or that has a green tint, the bluegill pattern is going to be hard to beat. if it's a lot of dark brown rocks and things like that, that's where that brown crawdad is going to become. But if these fish really focus in the spring on crawfish and bluegill in these northern natural lakes, so you want to match those forage patterns.
What's your go-to pump-up song before a tournament?
You know, I always used to roll Metallica. You know, just anything off the Black Album. I've really changed a lot lately, and I'm starting to diversify. My boys got into country music, and I'm listening to a lot more country music. So I have a lot of songs. I just appreciate listening to something in the morning. It is a great way to start the day.
What is your main trailer you use on a Thunder Cricket?
So my favorite trailer on a Thunder Cricket really depends on the water clarity and what I'm trying to accomplish with it. Without a doubt, a Straight King Menace Grub is a really good trailer for it. It's got a lot of action. It's a little smaller profile. It helps it run a little bit deeper. A Blade Minnow is something that's really good. I like it in colder water, so it's probably my favorite early spring trailer. Doesn't have the kicker tail like a swim bait does. You know, a Rage Swimmer is another good one. A 325 Rage Swimmer is a great trailer on the back of a Thunder Cricket. And, you know, it really just depends. So we've got a new bait called a Punch Bug that, you know, I've been using a lot lately because it's got a bulkier body and it's got great, you know, Rage tail legs to it. And it's unbelievable for skipping boat docks and things like that. So I don't know that there's necessarily, you know, one perfect choice, but, you know, if the water's got a little, color to it or anything like that, I like something that has some extra action, you know, a swimming tail to it. If it's clear, I want something that's subtler, and that's where, you know, that Blade Minnow is really going to come into play. So just kind of mix it up and, you know, pick a bait that helps you get to the depth zone that you want. You know, one of the things that's really helped is the new Thunder Crickets now come in a 5/8 and a 3/4 ounce size. So before, instead of having to use a less bulky trailer to help get the bait deeper, now I can go to a heavier bait. You know, a lot of our lakes up here, I want to throw that 3/4 ounce because I want to fish it in 10, 12 foot of water. And, you know, a bladed jig has a lot of lift to it. So the trailer is a big part of the running depth of that bait. So it's not just about the action. I use the trailer to help control the running depth.
This is from Alan McGuckin.
Big Alan.
Isn't very possible these days. Give us a killer tip for the backyard grill.
So we are doing a lot of cooking out. And gosh, that's something that we all love to do. The boys and I, for sure. There's so many, I have so many good recipes, but one of the ones that is incredibly easy that we do if you're in a hurry is ribs that you pre-bake. And what you can do is just take some baby back ribs, put them in a tin with 7-Up, just cover them completely with regular 7-Up, and put them in the oven for about 2.5 hours at 350, and it cooks all that fat and all that gristle off them, and then you can just put them on the grill and finish them with your favorite sauce. So you know, last year I got my first Traeger grill, and these pellet grills are unbelievable because of the temperature control. And, you know, I've cooked everything with them. It takes a little more time, but you can cook crazy chicken legs, chicken wings. I love chicken wings, but actually chicken legs are probably my favorite, you know, and it takes about 2.5 hours. You cook them on that Traeger, cook them at 250, just season them up, spray them with a little apple juice at the beginning and then probably every 20 minutes or so. And they are crazy, you know, kiss your mama good when you get done. I mean, they are unbelievable. So that Traeger makes makes me look like a hero on a regular basis. But we just keep experimenting with a lot of different things. And, you know, you can really never go wrong. It's kind of like a few years ago, I got a Cajun fryer, and we have fried everything from corn on the cob. Fried avocados are one of our favorite things that we can do. I've fried hard-boiled eggs. I mean, we have fried all kinds of different vegetables. You know, I love fried jalapeno slices. Banana peppers are incredible. We do a little bit of everything. So I love cooking out. It's a great time to be able to do that right now with this lockdown.
Here's another good one. How have you learned to be so versatile, Dan?
So for me, being versatile really is kind of where I grew up from more than anything. You know, coming from Michigan, we just have such a diversity of lakes. You know, I mean, there's shallow, you know, rivers with dirty water. There's a lot of, you know, there's river systems that have a lot of vegetation. You know, we've got deep, clear, rocky lakes. We've got, you know, everything in between, you know, smallmouth, largemouth, just a lot of diversity. So you have to be, you know, open to fishing in 40 foot of water. And, you know, I've learned everything from jigging spoons to deep cranking to, you know, top waters and finesse fishing. The hardest thing for me in being versatile is learning to put down the power baits and pick up a finesse bait, you know, but that's something in the, you know, recent years that I know that you have to do. So I've gotten a lot more adept with, you know, I'm not afraid to throw a shaky head and a drop shot and a Ned rig and, you know, a Nico rig. Nico rig is one of my favorite new techniques. It's just deadly. So now there's the Tokyo rig. There's a lot of different new things out there that you can finesse fish. But I try to find ways to fish even those slow techniques even faster. And that's something that it's just my nature. I'm just a nervous person. I like to cover water and that's my style. So everybody has to be comfortable with what you're doing. And, you know, I just happen to feel comfortable doing a lot of different things.
Here is one. What is your biggest smallmouth bass?
So my biggest smallmouth that I've weighed is a 7.9. And I caught that at Lake Wheeler, actually practicing for a tournament. I was with my dad at the time. This was years ago. It was early in the spring. You know, caught it on a lipless crankbait, and, you know, it was just a really fat, giant fish. Since then, I've caught, you know, lots of high six and even, you know, a 7-pounder here in Michigan. So our fish have really grown up here. Had an incredible day last year with Johnny Morris and Martin Truex, where we caught a whole bunch of really great big ones. But, you know, that 7.9 is still the biggest one I've ever put on the scales. Now, when the boys are laughing, somebody's got a funny question. And I knew this was eventually going to get that way. But
no.
It's not that funny?
Well, not.
I got a question for you. This guy says, goat. Do you take over their lures or use them right out of the package?
So I pretty much, I do a lot of minor changes. I change a lot of hooks. I, you know, switch really all my treble hooks out to Mustad KVD triple grips on my hard baits. You know, I trim spinnerbait skirts. I trim jig skirts, things, you know, add trailers. I'll trim trailers up and things like that. But for the most part, the lure itself, you know, you just don't have to doctor. You know, I mean, I was one of the first guys years ago to build my own suspending crankbaits and jerkbaits. You know, I would drill them out, add weights to them and things like that. But technology's gotten so much better, and our lure design is so much better that you really don't have to anymore. You know, you can do some minor things. You can still add some weight to, you know, suspend dots or, you know, add some weights to the front hook hanger and that to make regular crankbait suspend and that. But I don't have to do sanding or modifying or drilling or things on baits anymore. I work real close with the lure designers at Strike King. And, you know, we've got a lot of things out, and it's just so much better. technology has changed lure design in that sense too. Now with, you know, rapid prototyping and all these, you know, computer aided design systems, we can basically kind of fast track some of these things. It's still very hard to build really quality hard baits, jerk baits, topwaters, crank baits, you know, molded baits, you know, and to get the actions and the depth and the running, you know, to get them to run right. It still takes multiple, you know, prototypes and things like that. But pretty much what you get in the package, at least from Strike King, you really have to do very little to, you know, most of our spinner baits now come already with the trailer hooks, even on them, for instance.
Here's one, Dan. Kevin, how did you determine if a pattern is coming on or fading away?
That is a really good question. You're always, you know, trying to figure that out. I mean, in the best case scenario, you're trying to find patterns that are going to get better, that, you know, that's going to come to you, that you're going to get more opportunities to, you know, have more fish moving in, for instance. And, you know, in the spring of the year, if you can be on that front end of a wave of fish moving up, you know, that's when you can have some incredible days. You know, when you find them in practice, you just get one or two bites and then it just keeps getting better and better. That's what you're looking for. Unfortunately, you can't always be on the front end of that. And it's critical to kind of really pay close attention to the conditions, watching the water level, you know, do things like that. That's exactly what happened to me at Lake Fork at the last event. Is in, you know, on the Bass Pro Tour, we start out with a day in between Group A and Group B. And, you know, my first day was really good. I figured it out. The fish were real shallow. They were moving up thinking about spawning. And, you know, the next time that I went out and fished, I noticed almost right away that the water looked just a little bit lower. And I, as it went on, I could see that they had dropped the water. You know, we had a cold front come through, and they had dropped the water about 2 inches, and the bass in the shallow creeks where I was at in the upper end of the lake, they just bolted. I mean, they just vacated. I caught some small males in that, and as slow as you had to fish for them, it was just, it took me a while to figure it out, and it was just a tough day that, you know, it's very hard to overcome that. You know, there's in some instances you just can't get around it. You just have to try to grind through it.
Hey, Dad, this guy is saying 360 or side imaging, if you had to choose, which one?
So if you had to choose between the new 360 mega imaging and side imaging, I'm going to tell you, you want the 360 mega. And the reason is because you, with it, you can have both. You know, I've got it mounted on my trolling motor, and it is arguably, again, one of the biggest game changers. People say that all the time lately, you know, oh, this is a game changer. Well, the 360 mega imaging, the picture that you get, it's absolutely ridiculous. I think, you know, Hummingbird side imaging is the best out there. It's got the clearest picture. This 360 mega is basically the same thing constantly all around the boat. So you can actually program your 360 mega on the front of the boat to be just side imaging, to where the cone doesn't spin in a circle and it just side images, and it's crystal clear like that. But I really like the fact that I can see everything all the time, because the pod for the 360 is not mounted on the trolling motor head or on the shaft. It doesn't matter where my trolling motor's turned. I see everything out in front of the boat to the sides. And it is crazy what it's already done for me. At Lake Fork, you know, I was on a jerkbait pattern where I could actually just see that, just all I was doing was looking at the 360 and saying, oh, there's a tree over there, throw to it. You know, at Lake Eufaula, the lake came up 3 feet and it flooded a lot of these shallow grass patches. You couldn't see them. Well, at 360, they just stand out like a sore thumb. You can see the exact distance and direction. And in a lot of cases, you know, with brush and bushes and tops and things like that, dock pilings, you see the fish, you know, sitting there too. So it is crazy, the advancement over what we had in 360 to this new 360 mega that I've got now. It is it's unreal. You know, I know that a lot of guys are using the live scope and things like that, but what I'm seeing on this, I don't know, gosh, that it's really any that you could see anything better, because it shows you everything. And again, you don't have to be pointed at it. It's constantly refreshing every time that it goes around with a new clean picture, and it shows you everything out there. I mean, you go down the bank and see things that you had no idea that are there. You know, every stump, every pot of bait. I didn't realize, you know, in these lakes that I fish so shallow, just how many different bluegill beds there are that I would have never guessed were in that area. You see, you know, last year's bluegill bed. So I know that's going to really pay off for me as we get into the bluegill spawning season, because those bass just hang around those bedding areas so much.
And how do you keep in shape to handle sitting up for multiple consecutive days? And then, yeah.
So, you know, for me, you know, I'm getting up there in age, and I've never really struggled with, you know, being able to fish even back-to-back tournaments, you know, tough weeks where you might be jerking a jerkbait for 7 days straight, or throwing a 6XD, you know, for 7 days straight. You know, I just, once you get into that fishing shape, it's important. The one thing that I think that is critical is each day at the start of the day, I take a few minutes and I stretch out. You know, I stretch my hands, my wrists, my elbows, my shoulders, just take a few minutes. And then, you know, that first cast, you know, if I'm on a crankbait pattern, I'm fishing a ledge tournament like Kentucky Lake, and your first cast needs to be a bomb with a 6XD, you got to work into it. You know, you got to warm up just like a baseball player or football player is. You know, don't make your first cast one where you're trying to knock it out of the park. You know, just warm up a little bit, stretch out. And, you know, for me, knock on wood, it's kept me away from any, you know, elbow injuries, wrist injuries, back injuries, things like that. You know, our equipment's gotten so much better. Our boats are so much better that it's really helped. Some of the guys that I grew up fishing with have had some serious health problems, and that's just the difference in how much better all of our equipment is now.
Okay, here's one. Hold on. If you had to catch a 25-pound limit tomorrow to save the world, what lake are you going to, and why?
Well, there's several places you could definitely go. I mean, if we're talking public water, there's lots of private lakes that you could make that happen on pretty easy. But, you know, Lake Fork would be one, you know, Lake Okeechobee would be one, especially this time of year. There's no doubt about that. But, you know, a lot of these lakes, it's such a timing thing. Santee Cooper is another one that's just incredible, you know, this time of year. Obviously, you know, everybody knows about Falcon Lake and things like that. There's some great lakes in California, but you got to pick a lake that fits your style. And, you know, you could go to Lake Fork right now after what I saw down there recently. And it's arguably one of the best big bass lakes that has more 5 to 8 pound bass in it than just about any place there is for its size.
And then, ever use hair jigs for smallies?
Yeah. So the big thing for smallmouth is the marabou hair jigs. You know, growing up, when I, you know, first started fishing, we used a lot of marabou jigs and deer hair, you know, jigs, just smaller jigs. And we tipped them with actually a twin tail pork trailer. You can't even get pork rind trailers anymore. But back then it was an Uncle Josh, like a U2 twin tail pork rind trailer. You put that on a 1/4 ounce black marabou jig or a brown marabou jig. Was a deadly combination, just had a lot of action to it. You know, now, you know, hair jigs are definitely good in cold water, but where the marabou jigs really shine in these clear water northern smallmouth fisheries, and it seems like the places that have populations of leeches are where they are just really dominant, you know, New York, upstate New York, Canada, places like that. You can take a 16th ounce marabou hair jig, black is the best, but you know, olive green, brown, and they're just deadly. It's like candy to them. You know, you throw that, you know, they actually do it a lot at Sturgeon Bay. They fish them on bobbers, so it's a finesse technique, almost like the float and fly type thing for smallmouth in the north.
And then what is your favorite snacks / on your boat?
You know, I used to eat a lot of different junk food when I was fishing on the boat. Snickers bars they're still hard to beat, but Sherry's makes unbelievable cookies, the chocolate chip cookies, and she's got a special recipe that's got extra peanut butter and sugar and things in them like that. But day in, day out, I really eat Clif bars probably and other protein bars more than just about anything else. But three or four different flavors of Clif bars. I like Gatorade, the low-cal Gatorade, because instead of water that has no flavor, it's pretty hard to beat. And it's important to eat things and to be able to, drink during the day. It keeps you mentally focused. So I usually start out in the morning with a protein bar and, make sure to hydrate and have one during the day. I still pack a sandwich on a lot of cases. With the Bass Pro Tour, we get 2 15-minute breaks. So I'll have a sandwich during the day. You can get time. But normally, I wouldn't even take time to eat a sandwich.
Here you go, Dad. Solix or Helix, which one or why?
Well, they're both incredibly good units. I actually made the change to Solix's this year, and the biggest reason for me is just the flexibility and the versatility that you have with the touchscreens on the Solix's. Now running Hummingbird 360 mega imaging on the front, I can go from one screen to the other as fast as I can touch the screen to see a side imaging picture wherever I'm at. If I want to see side imaging on the front, or if I want to see my 360, a lot of times I'll do that. I'll idle around with the trolling motor down and, with the 360 too. And so I can split screen, with all the different scenarios there. And the Solix just allows you to do that. And I'm not so sure that the detail in the picture, that's a really high powered unit, isn't better. So I've been really happy with changing to 4 Solix 12s this year. I have the one on the bow dedicated just for the Hummingbird Mega 360, and it's pretty hard to not keep your eyes glued to it. I see so much that I didn't see before. It's such an incredible tool. It is arguably one of the greatest advancements that I've seen in electronics in my 30 years of doing this professionally.
What time of year do you prefer to throw a caffeine shad?
A caffeine shad to me is a bait that is incredibly deadly in a lot of situations. It's a great pre-spawn bait when a lot of people are throwing stick worms like, ochos and cincos. It has the same fall because it has a really heavy salt content. So I'll usually throw a green pumpkin or a watermelon red and just pitch it out there and just dead stick it. But the thing I like about it is that I can twitch it like a jerkbait still if I want to. In the summer or in the fall, I can fish it like, a typical soft plastic stick bait as well. They make it in a 4-inch and a 5-inch size. I just like it because it's real heavy. And the fact that it's got a heavy salt content to it, and the design of that bait with that flat spot halfway back to the tail that kind of has that rattlesnake end to it, it just, when you jerk it, it's super erratic, but when you let it fall, it falls horizontally, and it has that shimmy or that dying bait fish wiggle to it, and it's just a deadly bait. The caffeine shad is, I think, probably the most underrated Strike King soft plastic that most people don't know about out there. That is just a deadly, deadly bait.
Docks in Southwest Michigan in the summer, and what rod do you use?
So docks in Southwest Michigan are something that they're always have bass on it. It just depends on the clarity of the water and the depth. A lot of times the super shallow docks are one of the best. A lot of people like to fish soft plastic stick worms on docks, and that's because they skip very easily. So, some type of soft plastic is critical for dock fishing. I still like a real lightweight tube. Or even a jig, and it's easiest to do it on a spinning rod, and you want a shorter rod. So, like a 7-foot medium heavy or 6'10", A rod that has some real nice tip to it, but that still has a lot of backbone, I'm going to use, you know, braided line for that situation if possible. But I really like to fish docks with a bait caster, and, you know, skipping a jig and skipping a frog are two of the best dock baits that you can absolutely throw. So, you know, I mean, either of those, it takes a little bit of practice. You know, the frog you want to throw on braid. You know, I'm working on some pretty special stuff right now that you'll see later this year to make it a whole lot easier, I think, for anybody or everybody to be able to skip a bait cast reel on docks.
What is a good setting on Michigan lakes for the KVD Hydrowave?
So if you're not familiar with the Hydrowave and all the settings, the KVD version has a lot of built-in sound patterns that you can, you know, kind of set based on the terrain condition. So, you know, if the lake's got grass, we have patterns for that. We've got, you know, crawfish patterns. We've got different, you know, we've got all the different bait fish signs. You know, in tough conditions, the finesse patterns are hard to beat. The finesse and ultra finesse are really hard to beat. So if you got high bright skies, low pressure, or high pressure, no wind, things like that, that's what I'm going to run. You know, the power pattern is still my go-to, even around here on those windy, blustery, you know, nasty days when, you know, it's raining, things like that. But, you know, these other patterns, you know, again, some of the patterns for offshore grass, things like that, if you're around schooling fish, there's something, and they're pretty self-explanatory. The biggest thing is run the volume and the delay based on the conditions. So less is always more. So don't think that just because a little bit should be good that you should make it even louder. I want to, you know, if it's not very windy out, I'm going to run that volume just, you know, down on a low setting, just, you know, maybe just on one or two. And if it's a little bit windier, if it's maybe it's 10, 15 mile an hour wind, you know, I'm going to run it mid range. If it's really windy, that's when you run the volume up. And I pretty much always use at least a 30-second delay. The tougher the conditions, the calmer and the quieter it is, the longer the delay. You want a quiet time in between those sound patterns. You know, you want it to be natural for the conditions that you're in. And that's really what you're doing as you're moving down the bank and you have that quiet time. If there's bass and bait in close proximity and they hear that sound of the Hydrowave, one of those sound patterns, that's the trigger in a lot of cases to get them fired up to actually, you know, chase that bait. And I've seen that so many times that when the, you know, the Hydrowave comes off of that delay, they'll want to school and it'll be 20 feet from the boat or 30 feet. You can pitch over there and catch them, you know, two or three of them will chase some minnows or chase some bait. And that's what a Hydrowave is really good for. Or once you find a school, keeping them biting longer.
Here's one, Dad. Hey, Kevin, we're here. We're right here in Kalamazoo. My 9-year-old son wants to be a professional bass fisherman someday. What do you recommend he starts doing now just to someday reach that goal?
So when I started fishing, there wasn't like a playbook to be a pro angler or anything like that. There wasn't any high school or collegiate fishing programs. I started in a bass club when I was 16. And, you know, my older brother, Randy, who owns DNR Sports, he did the same thing. I started in the same club. And, you know, that was the way that I could learn is to fish with other different club members. And that's the from a fishing standpoint, that's the fastest way to learn, to fish with as many different good anglers as you can. And, you know, a club or that type of format is a much better way to do that than, say, team tournaments are. Other than that, you know, one of the keys is absolutely education. You know, today it's so critical to have, you know, a marketing degree, you know, to understand business, to be knowledgeable, to have a good education. And that's pretty much true in all walks of life. But in any professional sport, a degree is really going to help you a lot. And in this industry, especially, it's important to understand what companies need, what they're looking for, what it takes, you know, what motivates them, and what you have to do to be able to be a good spokesperson for them.
Here's another one, Dad. What fisherman has made the biggest impact in your career?
You know, it's really a ton of them. You know, when I started out, there was, you know, guys like, you know, Rick Klun and Denny Brower and, you know, Roland Martin and Jimmy Houston, Bill Dance. You know, I grew up as a kid watching Virgil Ward, you know, so that's kind of how I started. And over the years, I have learned so much from so many of my peers that are my friends. And that's what's so awesome about today with social media, with the internet, with YouTube channels. You know, we've filmed a lot of stuff. We're going to really start kicking out a lot more content, things like that coming up, where you can learn so much more without having to spend time on the water. I still don't think there's any substitute for that, but, you know, there's so many anglers that have taught me so much over the years. And I feel like that's one of my strengths, you know, today. I'm not as entertaining as maybe a Jimmy Houston is. But, you know, one thing I do is I have a really good understanding of fishing techniques and things like that. And I like to teach that. I love it when people come to me and say, man, I learned so much from that seminar or the show that I saw you do. And that's what I really am gratified by.
Okay, Dad. KVD, in the Bass Strategy Revised book, you talk about understanding forage. Say a few things about it, please.
So just like knowing the habits of a largemouth bass or a smallmouth bass or a walleye or anything else, knowing their life cycle and, you know, what motivates them and their preferences and things like that, it's the same for their forage, you know, to understand the habits and the life cycle of a bluegill. You know, where I live here in Michigan, knowing what they do at different times of the year, where they hang out, because bluegill are the number one most important forage base in these local lakes where I live. So understanding what they do at different times of the year and how they react to different conditions and, you know, when they're spawning and things like that, when they first move in the spring, you know, being able to see them on your sonar in the fall and in the summer, things like that, to know where they're at, that's going to tell you where the bass are at. I mean, they're going to follow the food. So knowing what forage is in any system, any body of water is critical. You know, if you go, you know, when I go to lakes in the Southeast and they have blueback herring. So it's just so critical to know the habits of a blueback herring and how much different they are than a shad, for instance. So knowing forage is just as important as knowing the bass.
How much has spot lock changed the way you fish?
Spot lock is definitely the greatest innovation in trolling motors for sure. You know, I think it's helped so many people be more efficient, because before that, you know, you have talons that work great in shallow water to hold you in place. But normally if you're, you know, out there in the middle of the lake and you catch a fish, you just keep blowing down the, you know, the break or the flat or whatever it is. You know, think of a place like Lake St. Clair. Well, now when you get a bite, you can just hit that button and it'll hold you there. So many times, you know, you can just keep that boat just locked in place. And it's more efficient to have that motor on spot lock than it is to try to run it yourself in the wave. So, you know, I actually have my boat set up with 2 8-foot talons that are the, you know, they're shorter than my Mercury engine on the back, just for that reason, because of spot lock. So if I'm fishing offshore and get on a school of fish or I get a bite, I'll just hit that spot lock, let that trolling motor hold me right there in the wind. I'll go to the back of the boat and I can still jerk a jerk bait or throw a big crank bait or whatever, and they're not in my way or anything like that. And if I'm in shallow water and, you know, I'm sight fishing or, you know, flipping mats or punching grass or things like that, you know, I'm still going to use those shallow water anchors, but out there in the open, that spot lock on that trolling motor is a huge advantage. That's just one of the things about an Ultrex that's great. The other thing is just how easy it steers. I know Jackson and Nicholas, they were night and day much better anglers. Their boat control was so much better the very first time they used an Ultrex. That was the most eye-opening moment for me, is watching them you know, run that trolling motor after using just a regular cable operated trolling motor before that, just how much more efficient, how much better they were when you add spot lock to it on top of it. It's just, it's unbelievable. That's why it's been as popular as it has been.
Yeah. All right, Dad, this is going to be the last question for tonight, but we're going to be doing it again.
Yeah, we'll do this some more. It's been a lot of fun. We're going to do one more question, I think.
So this one says, Kevin, after your tournament days are done, will you ever have a hunting and fishing show?
I love to hunt and fish, and that's something that's definitely on my radar. You know, times are changing quickly, and I'd love to do it all. Both of my boys love the outdoors too. Jackson's in culinary school, so we might do a hunting, fishing, and you know, wild game cooking to everything show. So, you know, I appreciate everybody coming on tonight. Hopefully, you know, some of the things really helped you, and you know, it's just so important for everybody to stay safe. We all need to help each other. We're all in this together. I want to, you know, I'm trying to be as positive as I can. And it's great to see so many of the great stories out there. And we're all going to get through this together. And the one thing I know for sure is the sun's going to rise tomorrow, and I'm still going to want to go fishing. So appreciate everybody's time. Enjoy your time, you know, enjoy your time outside. It's a great time to get out and go fishing, get on the water, and have some time with your family. So I know that's what we're going to be doing. Have a good night.